Good evening. And before we get started, I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight on this beautiful April evening. I was kind of hoping for like 50 degrees and a little colder. We get more people, but I really appreciate you being here. Welcome to our State of the Schools 2017 presentation. My name is Dan Perrin. I'm the superintendent of Danbury Local Schools, and I really appreciate everybody being here. To get started, we are going to start with a presentation from one of our presenters from the cabaret, and I'd like to introduce you to Ms. Caitlin Plummer, who's going to be singing How to Save a Life, The Fray. Caitlin.
Step one, they say we need to talk. He walks, you say sit down, it's just a talk. He smiles politely back at you, you stare politely. Some sort of window to your right, as he goes left and you stay right. Between the lines of fear and blame, you'll begin to wonder why you came. Where did I go wrong? I lost a friend somewhere along in the bitterness. I would have stayed up with you all night had I known how to save a life. Let him know that you know best, cause after all you do know best. Try to surpass his defense without granting innocence. Lay down a list of what is wrong, the things you told him all along. Pray to God he hears you. And I pray to God he hears you. And where did I go wrong? I lost a friend somewhere along in the bitterness. I would have stayed up with you all night had I known how to save a life. He begins to raise his voice, you lower yours, grant him one last choice. Drive until you lose the road, or break with the ones that followed. He will do one of two things, he will admit to everything, or he'll say he's just not the same, and you'll begin to wonder why you came. Where did I go wrong? I lost a friend somewhere along in the bitterness, and I would have stayed up with you all night had I known how to save a life. Where did I go wrong? I lost a friend somewhere along in the bitterness, and I would have stayed up with you all night had I known how to save a life. How to save a life. How to save a life. Where did I go wrong? I lost a friend somewhere along in the bitterness, and I would have stayed up with you all night had I known how to save a life.
Thank you, Caitlin. Now, this evening's presentation is going to be a little on the informal side. So as we're going through, we're going to be talking about academic excellence, visual performing arts, our STEM programs, how we're going to be enhancing facilities, athletic opportunities for our student athletes, improving our stakeholder communications, investing technology, and growth for the future. But as we're going through, if you have any questions, just raise your hand or say, hey, Dan, or hey, Mr. Parent. And you don't have to wait to the end. If there's something comes up and you're thinking as we're going through, just raise your hand. We'll do our best to answer them now. Or if not, we'll make sure that we can get the answer to you right away within 24 hours. So our academic excellence here at Danbury begins at Danbury Elementary. Our elementary teachers provide the solid foundation for our students. A lot of people in our, when I talk to people in our community, a lot of them don't realize that we start educating our kiddos, as our elementary kids call them, our teachers call them, at the age of three. They begin at our 3 and 4 year preschool and they work their way all the way through fourth grade, and our teachers do an outstanding job. All the way through high school, where this past year our high school students received 100% of 4 year graduation rate. That's about as best as you can get on our state report card, so they do a great job. But besides here at Danbury, our students are also involved in partnerships with our EHOVE Career and Technical Education Center. After their sophomore year, a lot of our students will go take a visit and try to find out, do they want to stay here or do they want to go more of their career and technical education route? And about 20 to 30 kids per grade level go on to EHOVE for career and technical education, and they do a great job there. If they stay here at Danbury, they can take up to 18 classes of college classes beginning next year and earn up to 60 hours of college credit. And that's in partnership with both BGSU and Findlay. So those, our students do not have to leave our building to earn up to 2 years of college education. Now, this past year, we have also gotten some awards for our academic excellence. We received the State of Ohio District Momentum Award. Our preschool, and our preschool teachers are standing here with their age, received our 5-star Step Up to Quality Award, which is the highest award you can get from the State of Ohio for preschool education. One of our senior students, Nick Bassetti, received the Ottawa County Franklin B. Walter Award for the Outstanding Senior Scholar in Ottawa County. One of our middle school students, Emma Holzoffel, was the Ottawa County Spelling Bee Champion. And our fifth grade academic challenge team was also Ottawa County champions. So we had a lot of positive academic excellence so far in the 16-17 school year. Now, one of the goals that we had going into the year, we've worked with Mr. Miller and with BGSU, is trying to expand our college credit options. How do we keep our college kids here on campus? How do we keep them wanting to stay here versus going to Terra or Findlay or BGSU Firelands? So we've worked from the beginning of the school year. When I say we, Mr. Miller and Mrs. Ward get most of the credit for that one. Worked with BGSU to start a new relationship with them. And we, starting next year, once again, we'll be offering 60 credit hours with our teachers teaching the classes. Also bringing on, let's see if I can work this. There we go. We're also going to be developing a new academic space in one of our current labs to provide on-campus dedicated space for our CCP students. So we're not taking the classes. They can stay here. They can work in collaborative space here. There's going to be, you know, there's going to be couches. There's going to be things where they can be, actually be doing some college classes here. Or if they want to take online college classes, they're going to have a dedicated space to be taking online college classes. So we're going to be making those changes. The second thing you're going to see, and Mrs. Hartman and Mr. Natecki, who's upstairs, who, by the way, I want to thank because he put most of this together and he gets all the credit for this tonight. So if you want to give him a big round of applause, he's right up there. 3 years ago with Mrs. Zucker, we started our STEM initiative here. And she does a great job. And if you have a time before you leave, a lot of the examples are on the back tables. There are some of the great things she's doing in STEM. But those kids that we started STEM with are going to be coming up to seventh grade very shortly. And then what are we going to do with them after that? So I've talked to Mr. Natecki and I've talked to Mrs. Hartman, and we're going to look at, next year we're going to look at what are we going to do with those students from grade 7 through 12 with another STEM initiative. We're going to be looking at other, talking to college people. We're going to be talking to other schools, other high schools, to see what that next step's going to be. And our goal is to implement that in 18-19. So if you're a STEM person or your kids are in our STEM program, keep up to date on that, and I'll let you know as soon as we know, you know, what that initiative is going to look like. And to give some of our technology demonstrations, Mrs. Sue Hartman is here, and she is going to give you some examples of some of the things we've been doing. Mrs. Hartman.
Hello. What I'm going to do is talk a little bit about what we do in grades 5 through 8 and show you where STEM has already been in place. So fifth grade, we start with a lot of keyboarding and also getting used to the Schoology, which is our learning management platform. To do that, I have some different creative activities for them to do, such as a word cloud. They'll take a screenshot and learn to turn it in so that they know how to use their learning management system early. Then we do things like, this is called Silk. It also ties in with their math curriculum. This is a music program, and they learn how to do live links while they create some music. This is an online engineering program. They have to get something from that orange tube at the bottom down to the box in the lower right-hand corner. And these are all ways just to get them more familiar with their computers and also with our learning management system. I do some coding with them as well, which is a STEM staple. And this is Kylene's. She has the code at the top, and she made a diagram of how a solar system would work. If you hit the button in the left-hand corner, it'll show all the different orbits of the planets. And here's some of our other students working on different coding projects. Right now, we're working on internet safety just to make sure our fifth graders have a good start on how to use the internet safely. Sixth grade, we're still doing keyboarding, but we move into things such as photo editing, and I do a longer course of computer coding. They start off with something very simple at the top, and by the bottom you can see it's pretty intense, and there's also geometry involved with the different shapes. And all of this is really good start for them to learn how to code different things, and I'll show you one of the things our eighth graders code in just a little bit. Right now they're working on video creation and editing, so that they're ready to do different types of projects when they hit seventh and eighth grade. Seventh grade, almost everything they do has to do with this digital citizenship. I use this program, and then I branch off to do some of the different topics that are listed on the screen right now. By eighth grade, we move into more of spreadsheets and formatting spreadsheets and graphing and putting all of their information together. This particular program, they were the Girl Scout cookie leader. They had to collect the orders, organize it, figure out how many cookies, how much money, and then graph how much of each different variety they needed. We worked into this radius program that gave some basic examples of STEM, things like binary code and cryptography, linear equations, HTML, and also explore a few of the STEM careers, which led into what we're doing right now, which is algebra combined with coding. They have to learn how to write functions, and they use variables, Pythagorean theorem, and they're going to make the video game off to the left. So they're creating small video game apps right now. At the end of this year, they're going to do some graphic design just so that we keep the arts in the technology as well. The program that a lot of people have heard about this year is my advanced computer class. I only had 6 students this year, but they did some pretty amazing things. They're allowed to come in and tell me what they wanted to work on. So we had photography, we had coding, we had some timelines and some geography things, but some of the boys especially like to do Google SketchUp, which is a 3D computer-assisted design program. And this is one of the boys. He created the house. You can see his pyramid in the side. And they did all kinds of drawing in 3D. Robbie, he got done with his house. He decided to make a marble maze. And at the bottom, you can see his drawing. At the top, you can see our final version of what he made. It took 3 or 4 different tries before we got to this, but this went from his idea on the screen to something we actually printed with the 3D printer. So that was kind of neat. Mr. Nateki's got our 3D printer working in the background, so you can see how that works. And right now, Everett, the ninth grade aide for Mr. Nateki, is working on 3D printing a prosthetic hand. And what we're going to do is put it together, complete with all the elastic to imitate tendons, and then send it off to a child who is in need of a prosthetic hand. And that is something we're looking at doing more of next year. This is some of the things that we did 3D printing, just a logo, and then the drones were kind of a hit this year. We started with 6 and we're looking to expand to more drones next year. But again, it wasn't just we're playing with drones. What they were doing was programming them. And this is one of the screens from the program that we use.
Thanks, Mrs. Hartman. One of our goals and one of the board's goals here at Danbury is to continue enhancing our instructional facilities. We began this vision back in 2010 when we renovated the high school. And then we continued on in 2015 with the renovation of the middle school. And we're going to continue it down here in 2017 with the renovation of our K-2 elementary buildings. Now, for elementary teachers that are here, we'll use my little marker here. This is what a typical classroom storage room wall is going to look like. This is what our teaching wall is going to look like. You're also looking at the latest state-of-the-art technology in terms of smart boards going to be in these classrooms, K-2. Is Mrs. Holzhoffler here? There she is. One of the issues we've had this year, and she's been great. We have a great school nurse. We are so lucky to have Mrs. Holzhoffler's office as a school nurse. But one of the things that we really need to do is we need to give her a better space to work in. So during the renovation, we are also going to be renovating our elementary clinic. Our elementary office is also going to be renovated to make that more customer friendly. And probably most important, we are going to redo the vestibule floor plan. One of the issues that we have is that the one main entrance to the building that it does not have a vestibule is elementary. And Mr. Humphrey and Mrs. Tibbles and Mrs. Steinberg do a great job down there in the elementary with keeping an eye on people coming in. But once you buzz them in, they're in. And there is really no buzz them in, come into the office, where they can come right in the office before they get in the building. So one of the things we are going to do during the renovation project is also redo the vestibule floor plan for the elementary. So besides the K-2 buildings, which will start in June, fingers crossed, we're also looking at redoing the elementary clinic. The staff break room is also going to get redone. The restrooms, I'm sure they'll make the ladies down there happy. The restrooms down in the elementary are going to get redone, and the floor plan. Now, no matter how much we talk academic, I've been asked more questions about this here than anything else since I got back from vacation. Since 2008, we have worked at acquiring property west of the campus. Looking at our campus blueprint, we know that north and south were landlocked, east were landlocked. So if we ever needed room for expansion, it was going to be west. So beginning in 2008, the board's vision was to start acquiring land west of us to start planning a west campus property acquisition. So we began in 2008. 2015, we completed the acquisition along with some donations from Lafarge, who donated some land to us. And we are getting started with our west campus property clearing. So the current plans for the site, as we sit here right now, okay, we cleared the land. Of course, I don't know if you heard, we had to have the land cleared by April 1st because of the bats. Believe it or not, the bats and the warblers, the two birds that they start nesting after April 1st, so we were not allowed to take down any trees after April 1st. So either we got them all down by April 1st or we didn't. So Mr. Baumgartner, while I was catching the sun in North Carolina, he was working with some vendors to make sure they got all pressuring those vendors to get those all down by April 1st, and he did a great job, and he gets a round of applause. He's standing right back there. He's the key behind this whole project. I just stand around and say, yep, that looks good. I like that. That looks good. So right now we're doing site and infrastructure prep. Between now, during the summer, leveling it, removing the trees that are already down, adding the infrastructure, which is your sewer, your water, your electrical, all that stuff you'll see that stuff start happening between now and the summer. Our other plan is to complete our on-site cross-country course to be able to use this school year. It's already been cleared. We're looking to, you know, smooth pave it and hopefully have that ready to go for this fall. Practice fields, multi-use practice fields. We hope to have those ready to go for fall of 2018 and have a softball diamond, which would make Mr. Coach Zelms and our girls softball players who always have to go off campus for softball, they will be able to practice and play on campus, hopefully in the spring of 2019. So those are our phase one plans. Does anybody have any questions on any of those? None? Wow. So those are our phase one plans. The board, working through its building and grounds committee with Mr. Baumgartner and myself, are looking at possible phase two. And if you want to know where everything goes, that's what the plan looks like. We're looking at practice fields here, softball fields here. This area here is a small area of wetland, which we could not clear. We are putting a retention pond back here in the northwest part of this property to be good neighbors to anybody who's north of us, just to keep any runoff from water or anything there. And this here is our cross-country trail. Now, for those of you who are getting old like me, having trouble seeing that, tomorrow we are going to have this whole presentation online. We'll have this online and Facebook and all that, so you'll be able to access this whole PowerPoint presentation. So, any questions? Total land with donation and purchase, a little over 50 acres. And like we were very, Lafarge was a great partner with us during this whole project. A lot of people don't realize for many, many years, the baseball field and part of the practice field is land that Lafarge has owned, and we've leased it for many years from Lafarge. So as we're going through this process, you know, one of the things they said they'd be willing to do is donate the land to the school district for what we've been leasing for so many years. So we really appreciate Lafarge as a partner in this whole thing. Yep. We are, one of the areas that we are looking at is possibly adding some parking. We don't have an exact spot where that's going to go, but yes, it's one of the conversations we have is adding parking. Yeah, Leanne? One of the things that Mr. Baumgartner, and I can speak for him, he's right back here and he can correct me. One of the things that he wanted to do first of all was make sure that infrastructure with water, sewer, and electrical was out there first before we started putting anything else out there for future plans for restrooms, concession stands, et cetera. Yes. Anybody else? Okay. If you have any questions, please feel free to call Mr. Baumgartner here at school. You can talk to myself. No, seriously. Our board members who are here tonight, Mrs. Bischoff, Mrs. Molnar, Mr. Sowers, and Mr. Mackey, contact them. They're fully aware. Over the weekend, I was walking through Lakeside. I was walking on the street. A amount of people stopped me and told me all the things we were doing with that property. And I said, no. No. And they said, well, I was told by three people that's what you're doing. I said, well, do me a favor. First thing I'm going to tell you to do is come here tonight. I said, and I'll explain everything to you, but no, that's definitely not what we're doing with property. Don't be afraid to contact us at school if you have questions. Okay. You can email us, you can call us, whatever the easiest way of communication is. But if you have questions, we're going to do, just call. We'd be more than happy to answer them. So speaking of that, we are continually trying, besides academic, improve our athletic opportunities. It's been a good year. Our girls cross country team won a TAC championship this year. Our boys golf team had the individual sectional champion in Grady Mark. Our boys football team made it to the OHSA state playoffs for the first time in school history. Our varsity girls basketball team were sectional champions. We had our middle school cross country individual conference champion in Gabrielle Merringer. And our seventh grade girls basketball team were conference champions. So it's been a year of excellence, both academics and athletics here at Danbury. And one of the things when people say, okay, why are we, you know, doing what we're doing on West Campus? You can't argue safety. I love our cross country girls, but I live down on North Shore, and seeing them running up and down the roads and around the road scares me, to be perfectly honest with. Having something there, having our girls softball team going back and forth to Danbury Township Park. Danbury Township Park, they do a great job. They're a great partner with us. They do a great job in those facilities. We're safer having those girls here. And our boys have not had a full-length 100-yard practice field for football in either middle school or varsity since I've been here. And it's just, if you're going to run a football program, it's nice to have a field that is actually the 100 yards you're going to play on Friday or Saturday. So those are the main reasons that we are doing that. Safety and providing quality stuff for our kids. Now, speaking of athletic opportunities, one thing that was in the newspaper was something that's coming up in the future. Beginning the 18-19 school year, Danbury will be joining the Sandusky Bay Conference, the River Division. We were a founding member of the SBC many, 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 many years ago. We're doing this to decrease our travel time for student athletes, more opportunities for middle school sports, and proximity to the SBC schools, trying to create exciting opportunities for trying to establish rivalries. So we are very, very proud of the years we spent in TAC and how we were treated in TAC, but we were also excited about joining Sandusky Bay Conference beginning in 2018-19 school year. So that's our athletic future. Now, besides academics and athletics, we have a great art and music program. If you have a time before you leave, I asked Mrs. Mark to provide some K-6 samples from our art students. Mrs. Letterhost is still on maternity leave with her cute little baby, so I wasn't going to bother her because she deserves spending time with her child. We are excited about honor band and choir qualifiers, our art show winners, both at the Five County Art Show and Art Show here. If you have time in May, I strongly encourage you come to some of our elementary concerts, high school concerts, and our art shows. They're here. They are awesome. Take a few minutes and stop by in May and take a look at those. And speaking of great performing artists, I would like to introduce you to one of ours, Miss Sarah Bassetti. Who will be singing True Grit.
So this is actually an original song, so I hope you like it.
Sometimes bad day is an understatement when the whole year feels like a bad rearrangement. Sometimes your luck runs out and nothing's going right and you can't get any level ground, but you know you gotta keep fighting. Then the road gets rough and you try to be tough, but everything in your head is saying give up, and you thought you were strong, but you're just told you're wrong, and the road less traveled by is looking so long. You need someone to help you, but who do you go to when it starts to feel like the whole world's against you? Take a break if you have to, but darling, don't you quit. True grit. Everybody wants to think that they understand you, but you find it funny, 'cause they've never walked a day in your shoes, and you've always been told that nothing comes easy, but the work that you're putting in doesn't seem to be working. Then the road gets rough and you try to be tough, but everything in your head is saying give up. And you thought you were strong, but you're just told you're wrong. And the road less traveled by is looking so long. You need someone to go to, but who do you go to when it starts to feel the whole world's against you? You break if you have to, but darling, don't you quit. True grit. And at the end of the day, if you don't quite win that race, you're gonna be okay. 'Cause you are so much more than what you've been through, and your value doesn't come from what you can't do. So when the road gets rough, remember that you are tough. Don't listen to the voices that are saying give up, 'cause you are so strong, but it's okay to be wrong. And the road less traveled by is worth that long walk. If you need someone to help you, there's someone who wants to. So don't think for a second that the whole world's against you. You've been going so long, darling, how could you quit? You've gotta give all you've got to it. True grit. Oh, true grit.
One more big round of applause for performers tonight. They were awesome, weren't they? One of our goals about 18 months ago, we were in an administrative meeting and we were talking about marketing. And Mercedes, is that you back there? Yes. We're in an administrative meeting. We're talking about stuff and marketing and talking about the district and what we can do to continue to improve the district. And we're putting forth ideas, and we sounded like we knew what we were talking about. And she said, listen, wouldn't it be a better idea if we actually brought somebody in here who does marketing and have them talk to us and about ways that we can continue to improve our communications with our stakeholders, with our parents, with our community members, with our alumni. So we brought a group out of Columbus called Allerton Hill in, and they did two community surveys. And when I was hired, I'll never forget this, one of the board members said to me, Danbury is the best kept secret in Northwest Ohio. And our survey proved that a point, because 48% of the people surveyed didn't even know we existed. They did not even know Danbury School District was there. So for us to be competitive, for us to be able to attract students, new students, we needed to find a way that we could get our brand out there, let people know all the great things that our staff and our students at Danbury have been doing. So after the community survey, we started with some focus group. We started an external communicator focus group called Laker Community Connections, which is a group that meets with me 4 or 5 times a year. And I think Mrs. Dunphy's here somewhere because she's one of them. We meet and we talk about school and affect school and how school can improve the businesses and how the businesses can help the schools and just allow them to be stakeholders, so that when people walk into their places and say, what's this about Danbury Schools? I passed that road right there and went, what's it like? They would have the information, they would have the knowledge, or if nothing else, they knew how to point those people to. They know who to point the people to. So we started that up, and I think that's working really well. Then we started focusing our district logo and branding. As you can see on the stage and on the screen, we came up with a new district logo, which has been received tremendously. A lot of our local businesses have called and said, hey, can I use that logo? Can I put on t-shirts and sweatshirts and everything? And the reason we did that was very simple. We wanted one of our students, Charlie Steinbreck, was during our contest, it was very important that we kept the anchor as part of the Danbury logo. And the more people we talked about, they said, yeah, the anchor is very, very important. The problem is, as you drive around everywhere, everybody has an anchor on everything. There's an anchor on sweatshirts, t-shirts, everything. So what could we do to make our anchor unique? So when you saw this anchor, you knew it was a Danbury local school anchor. So we came up with this, and we're really excited about our new logo. Okay, electronic media. Now, those of you know me, and Mr. Humphrey said when I was pretending how to do this, he said, this would be a great time to tell jokes because you talking about electronic media is just hilarious. But I'm not a big electronic media. People in this district for years have been trying to get us on Facebook, and I was the one who kept saying, no, Facebook. I don't like Facebook. It's ugh. Well, we started Facebook, and it took off, and Mr. Nateki is our Facebook guru who handles the Facebook. A lot of our staff members have their own Facebook pages and have taken off. And I can honestly say, boy, was I wrong. Okay, we were way behind in the Facebook page era. It's been a great tool for communicating. Beginning in January, we started Twitter. We have some Twitter pages. We have some teachers who have Twitter pages. Mr. Humphrey has a Twitter page, Mr. Miller, and they argue down in the hallway to see who has more followers, and you know, it's a big competition between the two of them. So they're on Twitter. I have a Twitter page. I have 9 followers because I don't tweet, so no one follows me. But it allows me to keep an eye on a lot of the other Twitter pages here. We try to improve our print media. We put out a quality profile in the fall, and then we've been putting out quarterly newsletters called The Anchor, which I think have been very well received. And people have called me. I had a lady stop me the other day. She goes, oh my God, I'm a Danbury graduate. She goes, I love those newsletters. It keeps me informed of what's going on. She goes, I'm not one of those electronic people. And I said, neither am I. So I really like getting those in the mail. And those have been a pretty big hit too. So we have been trying to improve our communication with our stakeholders, both in the district and outside the district. It's very important that people know who we are, what we're doing, and all the great things we're doing here at Danbury. Finally, last but not least, is our investment in technology. We have spent a lot of money investing in technology here at Danbury. We began a one-on-one technology initiative in 2014 when we got our staff on board with our Schoology learning management system. In 2015, we began our cart-based Chromebooks. And then 2016, we began our one-on-one Chromebooks. And this was one of those other ones, you know, it's August, it's hot, we're in a meeting. Mr. Humphrey, Mr. Miller comes to Ms. Parent, we gotta talk to you. This is one of those things we have to talk to you about. And I said, okay, what happened? And they looked at me and said, you gotta let the kids take the Chromebooks home. I said, they're not taking those things home. You don't know what's gonna happen to them when they get home. They're gonna break, they're gonna destroy them. There's no way those things are going home. So then they came back about 2 weeks later and said, they really gotta go home. So they kept hitting me, and I said, okay, we will try it with our high school kids. Well, we piloted with the high school kids. It worked out great. And then they came back and said, well, the high school kids can do it, the middle school kids can do it too. So then they said, okay, so then we're doing it 7 through 12. They're taking them home. And then we got down to 5th and 6th, 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th. And I said, no way. Those are not going home. Those are staying here. So 3 through 6 are staying here. 7 through 12 are going home. And it's been a big hit, really helping. We also are going to be beginning in 2017. We're going to take it down to kindergarten for K-1-2. And we're looking right now at which devices we're going to be having in those classrooms. We're not exactly sure 100% what those devices are going to look like. So we're excited about that, along with the continued investment in infrastructure, in our servers, in our hardwiring, in our cameras, and all the infrastructure that is needed, Wi-Fi, all that stuff that is needed to make this initiative work. We're spending a lot of money in those areas. And I don't know what all that stuff is, but I know if I open, when I go to Mr. Entecki's office and open the door there, this stuff is looking at me. So I know we got a lot of this stuff type stuff here, and we're spending a lot of money for it. So that's infrastructure stuff. Now, one of the things we do here at Danbury is we look at educating the whole child. And ways we do that is we implement a variety of programs. This year, we instituted our DEAR program in sixth grade this year. We had our graduation on Friday. It was awesome. Ottawa County Prosecutor Jim Van Erten was here as our guest speaker with our sixth graders. We were really excited about that. Beth Hubens, is Beth here? Okay, Beth Hubens and some of our moms who volunteer help out with our Kids in Motion program in the morning, which is awesome. We have 60 to 80 little kids running around. I mean, they're in the gym and she's there with one or two moms and you think that was chaos. No, it is so, she says hey or blows a whistle, they know exactly where to go, and it's an awesome program for the kids before school and they really enjoy that. Our TNT mentoring program from our kids beginning in fifth grade, which pairs them up with mentors. And the goal is to keep them with those same mentors up through 12th grade. And I know we have some mentors in our room right here. And actually, before Mr. Quisno came here, Mr. Quisno brought this program to Danbury last year, and it's been a big success. We're really happy about our mentoring program. Our kids do many hours of community service. We have an after-school latchkey program, and I think Mrs. Wise is here. Where's Mrs. Wise and Mrs. Speck and Mrs. Plotner do a great job with our latchkey program. We hold our Real Money, Real World program with our eighth graders through the Ohio State Extension. We have some peer tutoring that goes on, and we have plenty of annual assemblies. So during the year, we try our best to make sure that we are educating the whole child and with giving every kid a variety of opportunities. So, where does that leave us now? We are not perfect. I say every year, I say a few things to staff every year. One of them, I say, you either get better or worse every year. Our goal is to continue to getting better. And we got to continue to improve. The other thing that I can tell you is I say to the staff every year at the staff, I tell you two things. I say, number one, make sure you check your personnel file once every year. And the last thing I say to them when I leave in the beginning of the year is love the kids first, educate them second. And I can guarantee everyone in this room, out of everything I say all year, that's the one thing our staff takes heart, because our staff spends every minute of every day loving our kids. And that is what the Danbury difference is, and they deserve a round of applause to the staff that's in here. But there are areas that we can improve in. One of the areas that continues to bother me, and if you look at the media and stuff, is we have to do a better job. You saw Sue Hartman educating internet safety in fifth grade and sixth grade, and I know Holly Gass talks about it. We have assemblies. We need to do a better job partnering with our parents to make sure that technology is a tool for instructional excellence, but it's also a tool that can cause trouble. And we need to continue partnering with our parents to make sure that that tool does not put our kids in any harm. And we need to continue opening those lines of communication with our parents to make sure that when we are using that technology, that our kids are safe. Safety and education are the number one priorities for kids here at Danbury. And that includes when they're not here and they're on the tools that we provide for them. So that is something that we really got to continue doing. Secondly, we need to continue, like I said, our staff loves our kids. But as we continue to move on year after year, new kids are coming into our district with more and more challenges. Okay. We need to do a better job. When I say we, I'm talking me. We need to do a better job of giving our teachers the tools and strategic staff professional development to handle the challenges that we're putting forward to them in the classroom. We got to do a better job of that. We have a DLT meeting on the 12th this week where we're going to sit down and talk with the staff, with our district leadership team to set our professional development for next year. But we need to do a better job to give our staff more tools to handle those challenges that they're seeing every single day in front of them. And finally, I will take, I don't know if politically, Mr. Baumgartner and I went to the State of the State event that Governor Kasich had in Sandusky, and Sarah Benedetti was there too. But the one thing that, regardless of your political thing, or the one thing that Governor Kasich said is we have to continue looking for innovation and changes and continue moving forward. And as a district, we need to continue looking, what are ways we can continue to provide a better education for our kids here at Danbury? So those are our three, from what I believe is three areas we need to look for growth in the future and to continue making Danbury the great place it is. Questions? Anybody? Oh. Well, I can honestly say that's not going to happen. I can answer that one. That's not going to happen. Other questions, but I appreciate the sentiment. Anybody else? Well, I appreciate you taking 50 minutes with us tonight. Once again, if you have questions, if you're leaving here, you have an idea, you have a question. If you have a pound, I'll give you my phone number, my cell phone number, 440-315-0645. Give me a call personally. You can call me here at the school. You can email me at parentd@danburyschools.org. You can talk to our board members. Our board members are really, really good at listening and taking information. If they don't know the answer, they will text me or call me or call Mr. Baumgartner, and we will get the answer for you. Do not, if anything else, if I have any criticism of this district, it's the only criticism I have in 10 years, we do not do a great job, if we have a question, asking the question to the people who are going to know the answer. To everybody else, we talk, you know, down here or there, wherever, but we don't do a great job of saying, you know, pick up the phone and come in and see the superintendent, talk to the superintendent, send them an email or the treasurer or a board member, because we will give you answers. You might not love the answer, but we will give you the honest answer. So I want to thank you all for coming. Please take time to look at the STEM stuff in the back that Mrs. Hartman and Mrs. Zucker have put together, and some of our art show. Thank you for coming tonight.